Glory to God. Yeah, right before the service started, I was sitting there talking to Wes. You know, he's had some skin cancer removed from his face, and he had the bandages off tonight. And don't you think he looks a little bit more like Elvis? Well, I was telling him I thought he looked a lot more like Elvis, and then he comes up here and sings like Elvis. But really and truly, don't Elvis sing that song to Wes?
Yeah, he did. Elvis did a good job.
Well, I thought it was a good job there. Wes, I thought you done good. All right. Praise the good Lord, though it is good to be here in the house of the Lord tonight. And I hope everybody's had a very good week so far. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and let's pray, certainly, one for another. Marie Hooker has called and asked us to remember her in prayer. She had been taking some treatments, of course, for her cancer, but the cancer has now gotten into one of the lymph nodes in her neck. And she's going to have to start another type of treatment concerning that. And she's asking us to remember her in prayer concerning the new treatment that's going to hopefully take care of that lymph node situation there. Any other special requests tonight that anybody might? Amen. All right. Well, if you will, please, tonight, turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Exodus, chapter number 6. We're going to begin reading tonight in verse number 28, and we're going to go into chapter 7, verse number 1. And I'm really excited about this passage of Scripture because within this next chapter that we are entering into, there is so many things that God is showing us, and He's also bringing our attention to some very special things that we need to take note of, because I believe with all my heart it's going to help us in our daily struggles in life, our daily battles against Satan, and also our dependence and our hope upon the Lord Jesus Christ, that He is the victor. And I believe that with all my heart. Well, if you will please tonight stand with me, those of you that are able, as I begin to read from the book of Exodus, chapter number 6, beginning with verse number 28. And it came to pass on the day when the Lord spake unto Moses in the land of Egypt, that the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, I am the Lord. Speak thou unto Pharaoh, king of Egypt, all that I say unto thee. And Moses said before the Lord, behold, I am an uncircumcised lips, and how shall Pharaoh hearken unto me? And the Lord said unto Moses, see, I have made thee a god, and that's got a little G on it, God to Pharaoh, and Aaron thy brother shall be thy prophet. Our Heavenly Father, we bow before you, and what a powerful passage of Scripture here that you have shown us already. And I pray that, dear Heavenly Father, you would just touch us through it, dear God. Lord, encourage us and guide us and direct us, dear Heavenly Father, and help us to use these things, dear God. For these things I ask in Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, we've been seeing over the last several weeks how that, no doubt about it, that God had called Moses to go before the Pharaoh. And of course, Pharaoh, as you recall, is the most powerfulest man in the world at that particular time. He was the Pharaoh of Egypt. And the Pharaoh of Egypt was known or recognized as a god. And the people of Egypt would worship the Pharaoh. And now the real God is coming on the scene. And the real God is getting ready to battle this pagan god by the name of Pharaoh. And we look into this, and God is sending Moses back into the presence of Pharaoh. Now, we've seen how that had happened several chapters ago, and it didn't seem as if though things were working out any better for the children of Israel. As a matter of fact, things got worse. The labor was more intensified. They were having to go out into to gather their own straw, and they had to keep up making the same number of bricks. And the children of Israel, who at one moment there was really encouraged and really seen a little light at the end of the tunnel, thinking that, well, now God has finally come and getting ready to deliver us. Well, with the hardships that Pharaoh was putting on them, they began to turn against Moses. And a matter of fact, we read in the passages of Scriptures where the leaders of the children of Israel confronted Moses and wanted God to judge Moses, because they felt like that Moses had brought all of these hardships on them. And then we read through these passages of scriptures and back and forth until we get to this passage of scripture here in verse number 28. We see that the Lord is again speaking to Moses, and God is reassuring Moses, I am the Lord. Now, aren't you glad today when God reassures us that He is God? Aren't you glad that there's times when we just feel the presence of God and that we can tell that there's no doubt about it, that we're on the winning side? Isn't it good to know that we're on the side of the one who can create the universe and the one who has the power to do all the different things that are done? I am glad today that I know who the Lord is. And when I look at this and God is reassuring Moses, and it's good for us at times to be reassured as well, isn't it? And I'm glad tonight to see that here God is encouraging Moses and saying unto Moses that I'm not done yet. You know, things may not always work out the way we think they should immediately, but you want to know something? God's not done yet. Because the Bible clearly tells us that all things are going to work out for the good. And sometimes we get discouraged and our faith is put to the test. And sometimes, literally, we draw back and our faith fails us. And we don't receive the recompense of the reward that God has for us. Because simply, we couldn't see how that any good was ever going to come out of certain situations that we're in. Well, when I look at this and I see that, yes, the children of Israel were becoming more burdened instead of lightening their burden, I see that God is telling Moses, I'm the Lord. And basically he's saying, I ain't done yet. Because Pharaoh's getting ready to learn who is God. And Pharaoh's getting ready to learn that there is no God like me. And I'm thankful tonight that there is no God like our God. And God here is reassuring Moses there in verse number 28. And it came to pass on the day when the Lord spake unto Moses in the land of Egypt, that the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, I am the Lord. Now he's commissioned Moses to go and to speak unto Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. But listen to what Moses is supposed to tell the Pharaoh. He says, you tell him everything I tell you to tell him. Now, you might think that's an easy task to undertake, but you just try to do that yourself sometimes. You try to stand up and be the mouthpiece for God. You go ahead and proclaim the Word of God and proclaim the truths of God. I want to tell you right now, it's not as easy as you might think it is, because listen, if you proclaim the Word of God, you're not going to be the most popular person in town. But if you proclaim the Word of God, you'll be popular with God. Amen. And if you don't proclaim the Word of God, even though you might be popular with man, I want to tell you in the long run, you're going to be sorry that you didn't stand by the Word of God and by all the Word of God. And that you didn't just pick out the parts that you liked or the parts that you agreed with. Friends, that's not what the Bible's all about. The Bible is God's Word, period. It doesn't matter whether you believe it or not, it's still the Word of God. And when God says, preach the Word, He means preach everything from Genesis to the very end of Revelations. And everything in between there is no doubt the Word of God. And God has commissioned Moses, and He's going to commission Aaron to go and to preach and to tell Pharaoh some things that Pharaoh is not going to like. And Pharaoh's going to learn the hard way. You know, sometimes people can't learn the easy way. Sometimes people can't accept the easy way. And now Pharaoh is going to learn some hard lessons now over the next 8 months. I was looking at the timetable that all this was transpiring. You think about the time that Moses comes and begins to approach Pharaoh till the time that Pharaoh eventually allows the children of Israel to leave about April the 15th, about the Passover. It's about a period of time, as far as most theologians can come to conclusion, about 8 months. So it wasn't like click, 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 click every single second of the day or next day. Things were happening, but some of them did. But over the period of the next 8 months, and you need to realize this as well, that Pharaoh at this particular time, according to the Word of God and according to theologians who say that this period of time went for about 8 months, he's not got but about 8 months to live. Because when Pharaoh finally allows the children of Israel to leave, and we'll get into that passage of Scripture, the children of Israel are up against the Red Sea, and here comes the Egyptians' army with Pharaoh with them. And when Pharaoh gets to the Red Sea after the children of Israel have already escaped, Pharaoh thinks that he can do it too. And so Pharaoh and his armies go across the Red Sea, and you know how the story goes, that the walls of the water come tumbling down. Pharaoh and his armies are destroyed. So as powerful as Pharaoh thinks he might be, and now this is encouraging to me, because there are a lot of people in the world today that think they are so powerful, and they think that they are beyond God's touch and God's judgment. But I want to tell you right now that they are not. And just because God hadn't allowed lightning to strike them here in the last few moments doesn't mean that lightning ain't about to come. Because God's got a plan and a purpose, and God is going to repay, as we seen in last week's message. Now Moses here says again that really he wasn't really comfortable with going back and speaking to Pharaoh because he still has this speech impediment. That's no problem for God. But yet God here is saying unto Moses, I'm going to send with you Aaron, your brother. Now if we read these passages of scriptures, we're going to find out that actually Aaron is older than Moses. As a matter of fact, if you read in your Bibles there in verse number 7, you'll find out that God gives us a description of their age at this very moment when they go back in to face Pharaoh. In verse number 7, and I didn't have that on the overhead, I don't believe, Faye. And Moses was 80 years old. Now, what is a score according to biblical time? 20 years. Whenever you see a score, they're saying 20-year period of time. So 4 times 20 is what, church? Woohoo! Glory to God. That's 80 years old. So, now this, but here, now think about this before you answer. Think closely. Think carefully. Don't embarrass yourself. So how old was Moses then at this particular time? That's right, Brother Bob. You're the only one who had the courage to say it. He's 80 years old at this particular time. All right? Now, according to what we've just discovered, how old was his brother Aaron? 83. Way to go, Wes. All right, that's how old he was. He was 3 years older than Moses. Now, here's a clinker. All right, we know that Moses died when he was 120 years old. So Moses here at 80 years old has 40 more good years left. Do you know how old Aaron was when he died? Aaron was 123 years old. Aaron had 40 years of good living before him as well. And here's another astonishing fact, and you can find it. Aaron was 123 years old in the Bible, but you can also have to come to the conclusion that both them boys died in the same year. They're 80 years old now. He was 83 years old. Aaron died when he was 123 years old, and Moses died when he was 120. So both of them died at the same time. And when I look at this and I'm wondering, well, why is God at this particular time? Because God ain't wasting ink or space. Why is he telling us their age? Why is it important that we find out that Aaron is 3 years older than Moses at this particular time? I think one thing about this is that regardless of how old we are, we're not to come to the conclusion that God is done with us. Moses here was 80 years old and Aaron was 83 years old. And I went back and looked at some of the different ages of some of the greatest statesmen and some of the greatest people in the world. And a lot of the great people in the world didn't even get started until they were in their 60s, 70s, and even in their 80-year-old range. So listen, if you're still here and you're still breathing, God's got a purpose for you. Amen? Amen. I read one statistic and it was amazing. An 85-year-old man left California on a bicycle. He pedaled that bicycle 3,100 miles up to Boston, and he did that within 33 days so that he could have a high school reunion or a college reunion. I can't remember which. But that was an 85-year-old man pedaled across the United States on a bicycle. So I want to see some more spunk out of some of y'all people. But I think that's amazing, don't you? to hear Moses is 80 and Aaron is 83 years old, and both of them are really entering into their prime of life as far as their service for God. Of course, there's people that enter into the service of God at much younger ages as well, but God has not eliminated people because of their age situation. Now, when I look into this passage of Scripture, though, I see that Pharaoh has sealed his doom. When I read in verse number 1 of chapter number 7, I find in this passage of Scripture that God had had enough of Pharaoh. Now, Pharaoh has had his chance. Don't you never think that he didn't. Pharaoh had his chance to give way to God. What was it that he said when Moses first come to him? I don't know your Lord. And who is your Lord? And we remember that as we look at those passages of Scriptures, Pharaoh had his opportunity, but Pharaoh would not succumb to an Almighty God. I want you to know that there's a deadline sometimes that people cross. And there's no doubt about it. Right here we're seeing the evidence of this, that Pharaoh was one of them that crossed the line. God was now going to harden his heart. I believe, and I wonder tonight, how many people sat in services is every Sunday whose hearts may be hardened. Whose hearts may be hardened. Have you ever thought about that? When I'm up here preaching and I look out over the auditorium and you get this blank look on sometimes some people's face, and it's not just on a once in a blue moon kind of a scenario. I mean, it's kind of like on a regular basis, as if though they are not hearing not one thing that you're saying. They've not heard not one song that has been sung. They've not understood not one passage of Scripture. And it does cause me to wonder, have they somehow or another crossed the line when God has hardened their hearts so that they will not listen or hear anymore? The Bible tells in the book of Genesis that the Spirit of God will not always strive with man. And there's many other passages of Scriptures, even Jesus Himself says, unto the Pharaohs, not unto Pharaohs, but to the Sadducees and Pharisees, he says, I'm going away and you can't come to where I'm at. You're going to die in your sins. You're going to die in your sins. And that's a sad state to be in, but that's exactly where Pharaoh is at this particular time, because when you look at this passage of Scriptures, you're going to find out that now Moses and Aaron are going to go back and speak to Pharaoh. But verse number 3 there, chapter number 7 says, and I will harden Pharaoh's heart and multiply my signs and wonders in the land. And verse number 4 says, but Pharaoh shall not hearken unto you. There's sometimes, honestly, I believe that there's some people just don't hearken unto the Word of God. I'm at that conclusion. I really believe there's times that some people, it doesn't affect them anymore. And God's closed the door. And the Bible says that when God closes the door, ain't nobody can open it. And so I think we need to really be praying for God to give us an open door of opportunity, because there's some people that may have done sinned away their day of grace. And that's very serious business. It's very serious business. Because remember this, in about 8 months, Pharaoh's going to be opening up his eyes in hell. Now, 8 months before he winds up in hell, he had a chance to believe in God. And God did mighty wonders and works. Remember Moses? Throwing down the staff. Remember Moses sticking his hand in his pocket, coming out leprosy. Remember the things that God allowed Moses to do, and Pharaoh didn't want to have no part of it? Well, from this moment on, about 8 months from now, Pharaoh will be opening up his eyes in hell. You want to know something else tragic? He's been there ever since. He hadn't had a drop of water. He hadn't had a moment's rest or a moment's comfort or a moment's peace in these thousands of years that he's been there. We can look at verse number 5 and we can see God's purpose for this whole mission of Moses and Aaron going back before Pharaoh. And in verse number 5 here, this passage of Scripture, the Bible there says, and the Egyptians shall know, and here it is, number 1, there's two important things here in verse number 5, but number 1 is, the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord. Now, I believe that God has done some mighty, wonderful, miraculous things over the last little while. And I believe that anybody with any spiritual insight whatsoever should have been able to recognize that some of the things that have come to pass could not have come to pass any other ways but by divine intervention. But there again, you got that hardened crowd. And you got that natural man that can't discern the things of the Spirit. But if you're saved and if you've been walking in the Spirit, then you should be able to see that there's been a hand of God that has been placed on a lot of different instances, a lot of different things, and we should be able to tell that there is a God. And that's the first thing here that God is saying, that the Egyptians are going to learn the hard way. Because Pharaoh particularly has sent away his day of grace, God's going to harden his heart. But the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord. I bet America better wake up. America better wake up, because He is still the Lord today that He was in the days of Pharaoh. And my God today can still perform whatever type of situations He wants to perform. But He can also wash His hands of America if He wants to. Here's number two that you can find in verse number five. I stretch forth my hand upon Egypt and bring out the children of Israel from among them. So number one is, He's going to prove to them I'm the Lord. Number two is, He's going to bring them out. He's going to tell Egypt, I'm God. And then He's going to say, and I'm bringing my people out. I'm going to deliver the children of Israel. Friend, God is going to deliver us as well. Amen. And I'm looking forward to that. I really am, to the moment that hopefully we're in that generation that God's going to deliver out of this old world. I was over talking to Bob Talley yesterday, and he and I were just sitting there rejoicing over the fact that it could be today. That trumpet of God could sound, the shout from glory could come, and we could leave this whole world behind. Glory, hallelujah. Boy, won't that be great. But one of these days, God's going to deliver His children out from among them. Amen. Woo, glory to God. I love that. But what about old Pharaoh there? Like I said before, Pharaoh's going to harden his heart. And Pharaoh's not going to listen to him, not one bit. But I want to share with you a warning here. And I'm going to back it up just one slide there, Faye, to Galatians chapter 6, verse number 7. And this is an important point that we all need to take heed of and remember. Because in Galatians chapter 6 and verse number 7, listen to me, be not deceived. I believe not only are we living in a time when there's a lot of people with hardened hearts, I believe that we're living in a time when a lot of people are deceived. I mean, a lot of people are deceived. There's a lot of things that some people are just doing that I can't make not one bit of sense out of whatsoever. I mean, I just can't understand. I mean, even if I try to understand, I can't understand why they think or do or react the way they're reacting and doing. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Now, you go tell that AGLTABA, whatever kind of crowd that is that thinks they are, go to all these different restrooms. I'm going to tell you right now, my God's not mocked. And you can take your ball games and everything else, and you can keep them wherever you want to keep them. But I'm going to tell you right now, all that money in the world ain't going to keep you out of hell either. My God's not mocked. Those of you who think you ought to be able to marry men and men and women and women, I'm going to tell you right now, my God's not mocked. Those that think this is all right and that's all right, and they go out and run up and down the streets, they think abortion's all right and all this sort of thing like it. Friend, I'm telling you right now, my God's not mocked. Man, there's coming a day. There's coming a day of deliverance. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Mark that down. They're not going to get by. They ain't getting by with a thing. It might seem like they do at times, but I'm telling you right now, according to God's Word, they're not going to get by with it. And sooner or later, recompense is going to come upon them. And so we need to realize that God is real, God is true. He's proven to us that He is the Lord. He's promised us deliverance, and just as much so as He delivered the children of Israel out of the hands of Pharaoh, God is able to deliver us as well. Now, when I look into these passages of Scriptures here, and I begin to look in verse number 9 of Exodus chapter 7. And in Exodus chapter 7 and verse number 9, here we see that when Pharaoh, and God is talking to Moses and Aaron, and when Pharaoh shall speak unto you, saying, show a miracle for you, then thou shalt say unto Aaron, take thy rod and cast it before Pharaoh, and it shall become a serpent. That's one of the most famous things that you can remember as a child from the Bible, isn't it? You remember it from when Moses on the movie TV, and that's a picture from that movie on TV where the serpent was presented before Pharaoh there in that particular case. I just want to throw this out there to you, that the Hebrew word for serpent, it can mean a reptile of any type. It can also mean a dragon or a crocodile. I'm just throwing that out there in case some really brainiac comes at you and tries to, whatever. You can say, well, I said a serpent there in my Bible. I don't know. That's where I'm sticking with. It's a serpent. All right? I'm going to stick with that. So here he is. He's telling Aaron. It wasn't Moses' rod at this particular time that turned into a serpent. It was Aaron's rod. And God's going to use Aaron's rod a few more times, and then he's going to use Moses' rod a couple of times, and back and forth and back and forth. But continue to look at this passage of the Scriptures with me in verse number 10 of chapter 7. In verse number 10 of chapter 7, "And Moses and Aaron went in unto Pharaoh, and they did as the Lord had commanded. And who casted down what? Aaron casted down his rod." Amen. "Before Pharaoh and before the servants, and it become a serpent." Now, when we go back again now and we see how that Pharaoh here is not convinced. I don't know about you, but I'd be convinced right there. All right? I'd be like Wendy Bagwell. I'd be making you a back door wherever you might needed one when you start throwing down serpents and things of that nature. I am not in for that. All right? But here's a serpent crawling around there in the palace of Pharaoh. But what does Pharaoh do? Pharaoh calls for his magicians, his wise men, his soothsayers. And we think that probably these guys' name, one of them might have been named Janus and the other Jambres, from the New Testament that tells us that there were two that confronted Moses and stood against him. But here is something vitally important that I want us not to look over too quickly tonight. Because when Pharaoh calls for his magicians, the court is filled with people. Now remember here that when Aaron threw down his rod, the Bible says before his servants and before Pharaoh. And so here we got a packed house. And here's a showdown between God, Jehovah, and little g God, Pharaoh. And Pharaoh now wants to contradict God. And he calls his magicians to come out here. And when we read verse number 11 of chapter number 7, we'll find out that Pharaoh also called the wise men and sorcerers. Now the magicians of Egypt, they also did in like manner with their enchantments. Now I want you to remember that, enchantments. What caused their staffs to turn into serpents? Have you ever wondered that? We're getting ready to experience some of the powerful works of Satan. And a lot of theological people today try to tell you that Satan is really nothing. Even some would go as far to say he is not even a real thing. I don't know what Bible they use, but it can't be the Word of God in any sense of the form. Here we're getting ready to see the power of demonic activity and Satan. The showdown. Because in this passage of Scripture, then Pharaoh also called the wise men and the sorcerers. Now the magicians of Egypt, they also did in like manner with their enchantments. When they throw down their staffs, what happened? Serpents. Their staffs turned into serpents as well. But what did Aaron's staff do?
Ate them up.
A lot of symbolism there if you think about it. Satan can throw anything at you he wants to, but God proved right there that God has the power to consume all evil. You think about that. And that was outnumbered, and it didn't matter to God. And God showed everybody in there in the room, just like he said back in, we was reading in verse number 5, he said, I'm going to prove to these people I'm the Lord. I'm going to prove it to them that I am the Lord. And so they throw down their serpents. Now this is something I want us to look at for a little bit here tonight before we go any further. Now as a matter of fact here, we need to understand that we need to be aware of Satan's devices. You don't hear very much preaching and teaching concerning the power and persuasion and abilities that Satan has. We need to come to a clear understanding that there's no doubt about it that we are in a battle. And from the book of Ephesians chapter number 6 and verse number 12, we are given a glimpse of the organization that Satan has and his demonic army. For verse number 12 it says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities. That's one level. And powers against the rulers of darkness of this world, that's another level. And against spiritual wickedness in high places. We got our hands full. Satan is well organized and he's got a tremendous size army that can carry out his bidding. A demonic army that travels and goes and creates havoc and things of this nature. So we need to realize that yes, we're in just as much a battle today as Moses and Aaron was when they were standing before Pharaoh. Because when you start trying to tell other people about the Lord, you go ahead and mark it down, Satan's going to show up. You ever went to somebody and wanted to have a little one-on-one good conversation with them about the Lord? You ever went to somebody's house, met them for lunch or something like that, and you just want to tell them about Jesus? You want to get an opportunity? Here comes the phone ringing. Here comes somebody over there visiting. You know, all this, that, and another, some type of interference. It hardly ever fails that there's going to be some type of interference when you want to do these type of things. I want to tell you right now that you need to be aware of Satan's devices. Because we're in a battle and we are in a war. Matter of fact, the Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians, and Faye, this is not on the overhead as well, but in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse number 11. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, and verse number 11, the Bible here says, lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. You know why Satan is winning? It's because, honestly, we become ignorant of his devices. We've listened to some Dr. Doolittle tell us that, well, Satan is really not that big of a problem. Or that Satan can't do this. I've had people say that Satan can't do that and can't do. I know he's under the authority of God and he can't do no more than God will allow him to do. According to the book of Job, he's not free to just go out and cause havoc and so forth like that. But we need to know the type of things that Satan does. And we can then see that it is Satan at work, and then we can confront Satan. It even goes a little bit further. If you want to turn your Bible over to page to 2 Corinthians there, and turn it over to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse number 4. That's not on there either. A couple of these I've just added recently to this, Faith. Then we'll get back to the other PowerPoints. But in 2 Corinthians there, chapter 4, and verse number 4, listen to this and see if this don't ring a bell. And I believe that this has transpired so prevalently today in this world and time. In whom the God, little g, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not. Now, I believe there's a lot of unbelievers here, and I want to tell you, it's going to be hard to reach them because, number one, they could have crossed the line. Number two, their hearts could become hardened. They had a chance, but they didn't take the opportunity that God gave them to be saved and so forth like that. But the devil, the God of this world, has blinded, that little g, it certainly doesn't mean Jehovah God, but the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. So there's a lot of passages of scriptures here that we can read concerning how that God warns us constantly about these things. As a matter of fact, and here's one more, Faith, in 1 John chapter 4 and verse number 1. And in 1 John chapter 4 and verse number 1, God again is warning us. This is real. The battles that we are in are just as real as the battle that Moses was in and Aaron was in. And if you're not facing the devil, you know the old saying is, it must not be that you're really doing anything for the glory of God. Because if you're going to stand up for God, you might as well mark it down. Satan is going to show up somehow, some way or another. So look at this passage of Scripture here in the book of 1 John. And in the first book, in the book of 1 John chapter 4, verse number, look, beloved, believe not every spirit. Now we're going to get into this, and I hope that we're going to be able to see, you just can't believe every spirit. And you can't believe everything that is done is that which is done of God. Because Satan is a deceiver. We should know that. That's one of his devices. The Bible says, be not ignorant of his devices, so that he would get an advantage of us. But one of the reasons Satan has got such a good track record today in the day in which we're living is because, well, we're not really being taught about what he's capable of doing. Now look at this right here again. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits, whether they are of God. Because many false prophets are gone out into the world. God's warning us, isn't he? Just because somebody stands up and say they are this church or that church, it don't mean that they are of God. You'll be amazed at a lot of different doctrines, and you'll be amazed at a lot of different philosophies, and you'll be amazed at a lot of different things that some people come up with. And I'm telling you right now, God ain't nowhere near it. You need to try every spirit. And I mean, just because some people are able to do some things like cast down a staff and it turns into a serpent, that don't mean they're of God. And we're going to see through the Scriptures that how that Satan does have powers to do a lot of things that mimic God's abilities. And even the Bible says that if we're not careful, it could even deceive us. Because here we're going to find out some very interesting things. And I'm telling you, to me, this is something that we've overlooked as Christians many times over. So we don't want to be deceived. We need to know some of Satan's devices. And so let's look at some of the things now that Satan is capable of doing, because we're going to be in a battle against Satan. And if you're not in a battle against Satan, then you need to get in the battle and help the rest of us out. And give some of us a break from time to time, because I want you to know here that Satan will always try to deceive people. He is the deceiver. All right? Not only is he the deceiver, but he tries to counterfeit everything that God does. And I'm going to show you some of the things that he tries to counterfeit and duplicate some of the things of God. And he's going to do that. And he is doing it right now. So let's look into the Bible here and let's see some of the things that Satan is capable of doing. Let's look in the book of Revelations. Now, Faye, I didn't put this up there, and it's a long passage of Scripture, so I'm just going to ask people probably to jot this down and go home and read it, because it's so many Scriptures that it would have took up 20 more different little slides and so forth like that. And anyway, just follow along with me in your Bibles. Revelations chapter 13, verse number 2. I want you to look and see how that Satan can do certain things. All right? Look at verse number 2 of Revelations chapter 13. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him power, and his seat, and his authority. Now, when you go back and study the book of Revelations, you're going to find out that when you're talking about the dragon, you're talking about the devil. And when you're talking about the beast, you're talking about the Antichrist. And when you're talking about the false prophet, you're talking about the combination of the evil trinity. God has a trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Like I said before, Satan's a deceiver, and he's a copycat, and he's also a counterfeit. When you read the New Testament, especially during the times of tribulation, you're going to find out that Satan is wanting to be God and worship his God, so he's the head of the trinity of evil. But he's going to have someone that's going to represent Christ and the trinity, and that is going to be the Antichrist, anti-against Christ, okay? And then, of course, that which would represent the Holy Spirit of God is going to be the false prophet. Okay, so you see the evil trinity here. And the beast which I saw was likened to a leopard, and the feet was like the feet of the bear, and the mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat. Now, what has the dragon done for the beast? Gave him power. He's gave him power and great authority. Now, we look on a little bit further now in verse number 12. And in verse number 12 here, we see, no, verse number 3, I'm sorry. In verse number 3, and it says, and I saw one of the heads as it was wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast, and they worshiped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war against him? Now, if you read and you study the prophecies of what's going to transpire, you're going to find out that somewhere along the lines, the Antichrist is going to be assassinated. He's going to suffer a mortal wound. But Satan is going to come along and raise him up. Now, what does that counterfeit? What does that copycat? The resurrection of Christ. And they're going to realize that it's Satan or the dragon or the beast that raises up the Antichrist. It's going to be a public event. Just like the resurrection of Jesus Christ wasn't hidden. It was a public event. And the Antichrist is going to arise. And what's that going to cause people to do? That's going to cause people that are left here on earth to worship Satan, to worship the Antichrist. Because the false prophet is going to continue to point people toward the Antichrist, which is pointing people toward Satan. Now, remember this. What kind of abilities does Satan have? We're going to see a lot of power that he has, but look at this power. He's going to raise the dead. Have you ever thought about that? He is going to be able to raise the dead. The mortal wound of the Antichrist is going to be miraculously raised up. Now, friends, I'll tell you right now, I don't know if the church gets, most of the church don't get too excited when God raises somebody from the dead. And I believe he's done that many times over. Somebody's had heart attacks and gone for 2 or 3 or 4 minutes, whatever, and God brings them back. I believe that's miraculous stuff. But you let CNN get a hold of somebody out here with a mortal wound, and here comes Satan buying all his glory or whatever splendor and whatever motions he does or whatever procedure he takes, and here comes this that was dead, and he begins to rise. I'm going to tell you right now, this world's going to go crazy. I mean, we got the risen Savior, and we got something to get excited about, but you know, can you imagine though the world would get pretty excited over that? And so they're going to worship him who has the ability to raise the dead. Now, why can't we get excited about and worship God who has the power and has proved it, not only with Jesus Christ, but he's proved it with many others throughout the Bible, and he's also proved it in this day and time which we're living in. He's got the power. He's got the power to raise the dead. But also, there's just so many things. All right. But verse number 3 there and verse number 4. And they worshiped the dragon which gave power unto the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him? And then we go into Revelation chapter 13, verse number 11. I'm going to close with this because, believe it or not, it's something. It's time to go. But look at this, and I'll leave you with this. And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had 2 horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. And verse number 12, and he exercised all power of the first beast before him, and caused the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose what? Deadly wound was healed. Who healed him? Satan. All right. Verse number 13 of 13, and he doeth, now here's talking about the false prophet. And he doeth what kind of works? And what is just one example of something that he's going to be able to do? So that he maketh fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of man. Now, I promise you something. I can get up here and preach truth all night long and all week long and all this thing, but the crowd's going to pretty much be the same. But you let somebody show up that can call down fire, and come tomorrow night, you couldn't find a parking place on top of this hill. But that's some of the power that Satan's going to have. And I'm going to, like I say, close and just read that rest of that verse number 14. And deceived them that dwelled on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound by a sword and did live. I'm telling you right now, the magicians in the days of Pharaoh, they were working under the authority of Satan. And they were using enchantments some kind of spells or some kind of repetition of some type of wording or calling upon whatever they call upon. I don't know what all it is. But I'm telling you that you need to be careful when you're out messing with things that you don't know what you're messing with. Fortune tellers and astrology and all these, you need to be careful what you're dealing with. We'll get into a little bit more of this maybe next Wednesday night. But let's stand to our feet now. Bow our heads. Our Heavenly Father, boy, I know that sometimes we feel like you've given us a pretty tough job to stand and proclaim truth in this day when people really don't want to hear the whole truth. But God, we need your strength and your courage to take a stand, dear Heavenly Father, in this day and fight the battle that Satan will rage against us. He'll come at us as an individual. He'll come at us as a church. But, dear Heavenly Father, in this day and time in which we're living in a desperate situation when I really believe that, dear Heavenly Father, so many people are deceived. And I believe that not only a lot of people are deceived, but I believe there's been a lot of people who have probably crossed over that opportunity. I believe they may have sent away their day of grace. I believe there's a lot of people in this world whose hearts are hardened. And Lord, it's just a sad situation. Satan is on a rampage and he's deceiving people by all kinds of miracles and all kinds of things. And people are taking it hook, line, and sinker. And people are not discerning the different spirits. And people are being misled by wholesale level, dear God. But help us, God, for these things I ask in Jesus' name to know the truth. For these things I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Page 305.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back.
Well, let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, it's been a great delight to have been able to gather together and pray and fellowship with other great Christians. And Lord, now your precious words fed our soul. And Lord, we want to go out and serve you better. Help us, Lord.